So I'm running my trip light power inverter this morning off of solar power. So I'm running my upright freezer, which is out in the garage. So in several of my earlier videos, I've mentioned that I've done some power factor correction on some of my large AC loads that I run around the house. I specifically did that to make those loads easier to run on this power inverter. Some of the loads that I've done that to, one is the freezer, and then the other one I did was one of my drill presses. So I wanted to show you how I did that. How do you decide how to correct the power factor? How do you even measure power factor? And what does it do for you? Okay, so here's my DC power meter. So we're doing 15.55 volts and 13.43 amps, 208 watts that we're putting into the power inverter. So that's power going into the inverter to produce the AC power. So let's swing over and we'll take a look at the AC power that's coming out of the inverter. So this plug comes out of the power inverter and then feeds power into this outlet strip. So we're getting 119.4 volts, jumping around a little bit, and 1.72 amps. So I'm going to write both of those down. And if we drop down, 145 watts, I'm going to also write that down. And here's the volt amps. If you take the volts times the amps, that's volt amps. So I'm putting 204 volt amps into the freezer, but that only represents 144 watts. And the reason that's off there is that's your power factor. So the power factor says that only 70% of the current that I'm sending to the freezer is useful current. So that additional current that I'm having to supply to the motor that's running the compressor and the freezer is what's called reactive power. So let's take those numbers and we'll punch that into a calculator and we can see the result of that. Okay, so we have the voltage, current, and power readings we took from the freezer compressor motor, and it's just a simple matter of plugging those numbers into this equation, and you compute a few intermediate values, and it'll tell you what sort of capacitor you need to correct the power factor. So this was the way I learned to do that in school, but there is an easier way. And if we slide up here, so this power factor calculator is on rapidtables.com. I'll put a link to this in the video description. All you need to do is enter the numbers. So we had 145 watts. So this calculator is in kilowatts here, so you got to remember that. So it's 0.145 kilowatts. And then the amps was 1.72. And we were roughly 120 volts. And all you have to do is hit calculate. So I think the kilowatt meter was reading 0.7 power factor. And if you go down here, so here's your correction capacitor. So it tells me that I need a 27 microfarad capacitor. So what you want to look for is put your calculated value, 27, and then most of their listings use UF for microfarads. They don't go by the micro sign, it's UF. And then usually if you put in VAC, that'll give you an AC capacitor, and you want a run capacitor. So the two kinds of capacitors you generally find are motor run capacitors and motor start capacitors. So a run capacitor is designed to be energized all the time that the motor is running. A start capacitor is just used for intermittent use on starting a motor. So you want to find a run capacitor. And so we could do a search here. You know, even though I searched for 27, it's showing me a bunch of 7.5, there's a 5. So you have to be careful because it may not give you what you're looking for, because 27 is kind of an oddball number.
So what I did was I searched for 30, and now there's a whole bunch of 30s come up. Here's some $7, $8 ones, $8. You know, this is probably what you would find at your local HVAC repair shop. They'll probably have, you know, something like a Temco, you know, name brand. You're going to pay $25 for that capacitor. Probably really good, but if you go down here, you can probably find them for $7, $8. Here's $4.51. So let's get one of these ordered, and we'll go back to the inverter. Plug the capacitor into the freezer and see what it does.
Okay, so based on that calculator, I determined I needed approximately a 30 microfarad capacitor. So this is a 30 microfarad motor run capacitor. And then I just wired up a plug on this. That's not the ideal way to do this, but just for testing purposes, I put a plug, and then I also have, I think, a 1 mega ohm discharge resistor. So I'm going to plug this in and watch what happens to that. And look at that. We dropped from 1.7 amps roughly down to 1.18, 1.2 amps. Let's look down here. Still about the same power. But now look at the volt amps, 142. And if we look at the power factor, 0.97. So that freezer is now almost a perfect power factor. And let's look at the power inverter. Again, this is the DC power going into the power inverter. You can see we've charged up a little bit. We're now 15.6 volts and right at 12 amps and 188 watts. Yeah, so I've saved over an amp of DC current and about 20 watts of DC power that I no longer have to put into the inverter because of that capacitor. So just plugging in a little capacitor can save me roughly 10% of my power that I need to supply. So if I have my freezer plugged into the grid, I don't pay anything for reactive power. The way to look at that is if I have a 15 amp outlet at 120 volts, I have up to 1800 volt amps of reactive power that I can have for free. I don't have to pay anything for that 1800 volt amps. I only pay for the watts that I use, but the power factor is not an issue. As long as I don't exceed the circuit breaker rating, I can pull as much as I want, but when you take that load and plug it into a power inverter and you're producing your own electricity, that reactive power has to come from somewhere. You know, it doesn't just magically appear out of the air. You know, I've got to produce it. So it might not be real power, but that current has to come from someplace. So this doesn't show up all that big a number in the half to 1 amp range, but let me see if I can set up my drill press and we can take a look at that. Okay, now I've got my drill press running, so it's running no load. I've just got the chuck spinning, and let's see, we're pulling 18.2 amps and 288 watts. Okay, here's the kilowatt meter, 119 volts. That's still the same. Let's look at that, 4.34 amps, 163 watts. There, see, we're putting 517 volt amps, and power factor is 0.31. The drill press has a pretty big motor, but it's running at no load right now. It's using roughly half of the current output of the power inverter. It's a 1,000 watt, 120 volt inverter. So that's roughly 8 amps of output. I'm using half of the current output just to keep that motor spinning.
Okay, let's go back to the power factor calculator and look at the drill press motor. So when we were testing the freezer, that motor was under load because the motor and the compressor are in a sealed unit and there's no way to run the motor without running the compressor. The drill press, on the other hand, is just spinning the chuck in the air. There's no load on it. So you don't need to do this power factor measurement at any specific load. You just need a consistent load. So for the drill press, we had 0.162 kilowatts again, and 4.34 amps. And if you want to, you can change the voltage. They just have 120 as the hard-coded value, and calculate, and there's the 0.31 power factor that we measured. And this is telling me I need a 91.8 microfarad capacitor. Now, if we go over here to eBay, 90 microfarad capacitors are available. Here's one for $35. Here's $17.50. There's a $45 one. But yeah, you can get these, but 90 is kind of an oddball number, kind of like the 27. So in this case, I found 80. It was a little more common size for a run capacitor. And here, $6.59, $11, $12, $16, $6.41 right there. This is even a dual capacitor. You've got an 80 and a 5 microfarad. So let's get one of these ordered up, and we'll go plug it into the drill press.
We'll hook up my run capacitor and see what that looks like. Okay, so I've hooked up my capacitor. According to the calculator, I needed approximately 80 microfarads because this was a larger load and it had a worse power factor. You saw it was 0.31, I think it was. So now instead of 4.3 amps, we're now pulling 1.3 amps. 145 watts. It was 162 before. So we've actually reduced the resistive losses. We're not having to pump 3 amps of current back and forth out to the garage to power that drill press. And there's the volt amps, 165. And let's look at the power factor. So we got pretty close, 0.87, 0.86. Let's go look at the DC power. Okay, so here's the DC power. Yeah, so we can say roughly 12.75 amps and about 200 watts. I was using 18 amps and 288 watts. So I've saved 88 watts of power and about 5 amps of DC current by not having to supply those extra 3 amps of reactive power. So you can see the worse your load power factor is, the more actual DC power you will save by plugging in a correction capacitor. So I'll show you how the drill press is hooked up here. Yeah, so there's my drill press right there, and all I did to wire in the capacitor was I took off this switch panel here. So the capacitor is basically just wired across the motor terminals permanently, but it's behind the switch. So if I turn the switch off, everything's off. If I turn it on, everything's hooked up. One thing I do notice with this drill press is it seems less likely to stall out while you're drilling than it did before. It just seems to run smoother. And now the capacitor is basically supplying 3 amps of current for free. All the current that comes in the power line is available to use for torque versus before, 3 of those amps got skimmed off the top. So it's kind of like you've just bolted on a little turbocharger on the side. So yeah, I find the drill actually works better with that capacitor attached than without the capacitor. Just to wrap up here, this is the capacitor I have running into the freezer. So I've built this little transfer switch.
So the idea is I can plug this into my power inverter.
And then I also have grid power plugged in on the top side there. And so the freezer is plugged into that plug. And then I plug the capacitor in up on top. The only problem with this setup is that capacitor is plugged in all the time. So when the freezer is on, it's doing its job. But the problem is when the freezer turns off, that capacitor is still connected across the incoming voltage. So what I really need to do is I've got to pull the freezer here away from the wall so I can get to the back side. And then I need to get that capacitor wired in behind the thermostat switch so that the capacitor turns on and off when the freezer compressor turns on and off. But anyway, hopefully that'll help clear up a power factor, and it's pretty easy to correct. Measure a couple of numbers, put them in the calculator, find a capacitor of approximately the right size, and then figure out how to hook it up. That'll probably be the hardest part, is figuring out how to get the capacitor permanently wired into whatever device you have. That's the only really creative part of the process. Everything else is just measure some numbers, plug them into a calculator, you get a result, and then just make sure you get a high enough voltage rating and get a motor run capacitor, not a motor start capacitor. And you should be set. If you have any questions about that, post up in the comment section down below. And as always, thanks for watching.